When you think of Mahabharat, Ramayan, Man Ki Baat, what do all these things have in common? Can anybody tell me? These are all imagined realities. So when I talk about imagined realities, it is to prove to you one thing, that these people who created these imagined realities are the strongest influencers that we know of. If you think influencer is a 21st century concept, no. It's been there for thousands and thousands of years, right from Christianity and Jesus Christ to PM Modi. So that's where we stand. And they are really, they are people who are great storytellers. Because as humans, we are all biologically, we are all meant to think differently. So how do you get a group of people in one room to listen to you? You organize a TEDx talk. Or you have these imagined realities. You can create religions. You can create politics. You can create societies. And that's how influence begins. Well, me being a chef, the first influencer that I met or I got influenced from my world was Chef Sanjeev Kapoor, who I think about 15 years, 20, actually 2 decades back, he changed the way India looked at food. The first time that I saw him, he made khichdi into, aaj hum khayenge shahi daawat wali khichdi. And you know, that made us think a certain way, that made us feel a certain way about food. When I was 12 years old and I saw his show, I straight away ran to my kitchen and I told my mom that he is using that Maggi squeezy ketchup bottle, which he's piping jalebis out of. Can you just buy the bottle? So she went straight to the store, bought that packet of Maggi because I wanted that ketchup bottle, the squeezy bottle with it, to pipe jalebis in that kadahi. So look at the beautiful brand placement here, where Chef Sanjeev didn't only touch our hearts, he sold us a Maggi squeezy ketchup bottle. So that's how you create original influence. And that's how, as a kid, I got influence. I started cooking. I started, in fact, going to weddings, going to restaurants, going to family gatherings very proudly as a boy who cooks and eats. If I had a hashtag when I was 14 years old and there was no social media back then, it would be how to eat at weddings. That would be my hashtag because I was so popular in my family that every time I would go to a wedding, they would actually wait for me to come because I was a boy who could have 12 ice cream milkshakes from the bar. I would tell them, Chacha ji ki shadi pe pav bhaji achhi thi aur Tao ji ki shadi pe gol gappe achhe the. So people actually started to follow me in these events where they would be like, wherever he tells you where to eat, we will go there. So actually, I have been an influencer since I was 12 years old, technically. And how did I find my calling? I was original. I was a 12-year-old kid who knew how to cook, who had a comment on everything he ate. Nobody knew if I understood food, if that pav bhaji was actually nice or not. We don't know. But as a 12-year-old kid, I felt that I was influenced by a chef whom I saw on TV, and I felt that I have the right and the power to comment, and I trusted my palate, and I could give my opinion. That was my first gateway to being an influencer. Now you can imagine how to eat at weddings, hashtag. That's how you eat at weddings. And that's my mom, very proud of me. And she's like, she would actually go to the market to get special trousers done for me. I was the only kid in my school who didn't have jeans of his size because I was short and was fat. So my jeans had to be tailor-made. And my mom didn't want me to be embarrassed. So she actually would go get tailor-made jeans done for me. But one thing my family never stopped me from doing was eating. So as I grew older, and I actually was really influenced by Chef Sanjeev Kapoor. I turned out to become a chef. I got my own TV show. And I had a sizable amount of social media following. I truly became an influencer in the 21st century. That's how it changed. But somewhere down the line, I forgot that being an influencer meant being original. When I was a boy, I was original. I was creating original content because I was a kid. But when I entered this whole social media influencing generation, I was also like, oh, wait, there is a cow. Let me click a selfie. And but then hashtag no beef happened, so there were no cows and there were no selfies after that. But yeah, so that's the generation that I belong to. And I started realizing that I became a follower more than I was an influencer. I started following a lot of people online. I started seeing the kind of work they do. I started getting influenced. But the thing is that as an influencer, also you have to remember that creativity and originality are the two things that you can't let go of. So very, very quickly I realized that if I have to stay relevant for a longer time, if I want to make a change, if I really want to be a boy who's going to inspire hundreds of Indians to eat butter chicken, I should look at this differently, where content is king and you have to be original. Those are two keywords that I work with. So I changed my approach from being this to being this. So this is, how many people know what this is? Kanjak, right? So Kanjak is that Ashtami thing where you get halwa, puri, chana, and you know, my grandmother would give me a 10 rupee note. Now it's graduated to becoming a 100 rupee note. And there's that roli dhaga that you see, that you tie on your hand when you go for a Kanjak. So this is the first time I use social media to tell a story. And that was about how my, when I was young, this reminded me of, how many people have seen Ratatouille here? That animated film, wow, that's not bad at all. So that last scene where the critique is having that Ratatouille and he remembers of him being a kid and those aromas, him being back in his village. And that's what happened to me when I had this halwa chana puri played about 2 years back. A friend of mine served it to me and it reminded me of my grandma, of how she actually made that halwa puri chana for me, and she used to give me a 10 rupee note and that roli in her hand. So now, you know, what the point is that once you start telling stories, people start engaging with you. I got hundreds of messages that day that I'm remembering my grandpa, I'm remembering my mother, I'm remembering my home. I have not gone home for Ashtami for so many years. I was like, wow, people have so many stories to share, so many emotions which are tied around food. And food is, you know, my grandfather used to say, a friend in need is a friend indeed, but a friend who can feed is the friend you need. And I realized that is truly the power of food. When you are an influencer who belongs to the world of food, you're dealing with emotions, just like how Chef Sanjeev dealt with emotions, where thousands of women wanted to marry him. And, you know, he was quite a heartthrob, charming, with his mustache. And a lot of people were disappointed when his mustache went away, including me. So, yeah, that's what food does. And this is in continuation with how we tried to change the scene. But as I started to create original content again online, there was this one fortunate day in my life where social media, and this is a pure example of how social media influencers are real. This is my side of the story, where I shifted to Mumbai 5 years back, and I did a housewarming party to connect with people on Twitter and on Facebook. So I invited 10 influencers from Twitter and Facebook, whom I felt I connected to my home, to throw a butter chicken party. Now this butter chicken is something that I have been very popular for in my family. I belong to a vegetarian family, and they all only eat butter paneer. So I used the same recipe to make a chicken recipe, and that became popular. Do not ask me how is it then called Goila butter chicken, because my uncle called me and said, why can't you call it Saransh's butter chicken? Why does it have to be Goila butter chicken? And the story behind that is that when these influencers came to my home, one of them came up with the hashtag Goila butter chicken. It was not even me. It was my friend's idea, where he ate this butter chicken and he's like, oh, this feels like Delhi to me. We do not get this in Bombay. Let's call it something Delhi. And they're like, oh, Goila sounds Delhi, so let's call it Goila butter chicken. How easy. There were 10 of them. I will never forget that day. I was still new to Twitter. They posted this hashtag. It went viral that night. It seemed like world had never eaten butter chicken. And it was like a new concept to them. And they're like, where can we get this butter chicken? I got DMs from New York, Australia, London. And I'm like, what is happening? Like, I'm somebody who does small plates. molecular food. And suddenly people are writing me, "Arey, Goila ka butter chicken kahan milta hai, main bataiye." And suddenly my life has gone from being this fancy regional cuisine Indian chef to being butter chicken wala banda hai, isko butter chicken banana aata hai. So my position in the food community changed very quickly, where suddenly people just wanted to eat butter chicken and they wanted to call me for this Goila butter chicken. I did 10 more housewarming parties because I was riding on that fame that Twitter gave me. And after those 10 more pop-ups, I realized, wait a second, we are sitting really with a golden hen here, because she's going to lay golden eggs and we're going to cook butter chicken. And that's how Goila butter chicken became a reality. And Goila butter chicken was born on Twitter. If you will go to our Twitter account, it's @GoButterChicken. You will see it says born on Twitter. And I think there's some proof of concept, because I at least know 5 people in the audience who've eaten Goila butter chicken. She's right here. Shikha is right here. Nikhila is right there. We have, oh, there are many. Not bad. People who have not eaten Goila butter chicken, 7400448081. See, I'm also, just for people who don't know, I am part Marwari, part Sindhi, and part Baniya. So, deadly combination. So when Twitter gives me Goila butter chicken, I make it into an empire. That's what influencers do. And that's how you influence people. So that's Goila butter chicken. And with Goila butter chicken came a lot of criticism, because I used to do a show on food channel called Health Challenge. And you know, when you are an online personality, people look at everything that you do. Nothing goes unnoticed. So you know, you have pros and cons of being on social media, of being an influencer. So people felt that my butter chicken was not in sync with my health challenge. And they were like, wait a second, this boy says be healthy and then he's selling butter chicken. Like, what is happening? Why is he being Jesus Christ here? So what I did was, and my butter chicken, actually, the recipe does not have cream. It has half the butter of the original recipe, and it has no sugar. It has honey, and we use cashew nuts to make it thicker and creamier, to make it more healthier. So to spread that message, and this happens so by accident, I started to run. I felt that my community wanted to see me being healthier as a chef. So I said, okay, wait a second. If you cannot not eat butter chicken, what you can do is eat butter chicken every day and run. So run to eat butter chicken became a communication that we started after that. And we got some crazy kind of traction. I started getting, and do not mind me, I started getting messages from Indore, from aunties, who would write to me, beta, aaj maine 3 kilometer bhaga hai, to main kitna bada pav kha sakti hun. So that's the kind of traction we got for that. And it was incredible that how such a simple thought, which happens to be, you know, you're a chef, you want to run and you want to eat. As a food person, one thing is for clear and sure, that you will never want to give up on food. So the only way to match up to that is you run. Just letting you know, one vada pav is equal to 35 minutes of running. So just in case, after our TEDx talk, you're going to go and binge, remember that. So that's how Run to Eat came into being. And just to sum this all up, Singapore Tourism reached out to us last year in July to tell me that there's a fam trip that's happening. And I asked them that, why should I go on a familiarization trip to Singapore? Like, I don't want a free trip. I have already been to Singapore thrice. I have nothing to see. So what are you really offering? Are you offering me money? No. So okay, fine. Are you offering me media paid partnership? No. So what are you really offering me? And as an influencer, I think it's very important to ask these questions. If you are an original content creator, and if you really believe that only by creating original content can you have genuine partnerships with brands, so you have to really put a foot forward and ask for what do you want. So I told them, fine, if you can't pay me, just allow 2 people to travel with me, and we will create a show called Run to Eat. And they said, okay, fine, sounds exciting. We don't mind sponsoring a trip for 2 other people with you. And let's see how Run to Eat Singapore shapes up.
What we do here is go back, 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 back.
Most people run to stay fit. Some focus on their thoughts. others soak in the view. I'm Saransh, and food is my life. Whether it's in the kitchen, at a table, or in the streets, when I run to eat. Join me on a journey through Asia's food paradise. A mix of modern and traditional, quirky, eclectic, and oh, ever so delicious. This is Singapore.
So well, that is my journey from being a 12-year-old hashtag how to eat at weddings. I'm here, run to eat. And yeah, I used to be 93 kgs. Now I am about 68. And I must tell you that I eat my butter chicken twice a week. I am a non-vegetarian, my family isn't. So yeah, you know what I would like to sum up by saying is that being an influencer is all about storytelling and not story selling. So it's very important. Do not forget that. Be original. Thank you.